The thing about Kiss Land is that Kiss Land, you know, I think people expected Beauty Behind the Madness after
yeah.
Trilogy.
Yeah. Because
it's like
yes.
he signed this label. He's like, you know, gonna be this you know, commercial artist. And I kind of gave him the curveball. I'm like, you know what? I'm just gonna give you an extension of Trilogy
yeah.
and kind of let the world know that I'm still doing this as well. And it was a claustrophobic body of work and very personal,
yeah.
Very like lyrical.
Yeah.
It was a very theater type record where it was about the theme and the brand and the visuals. And this kind of universe that I created.
Kiss Land is a weird album. It's the Weeknd album that no one really talks about. The Weeknd album that's kind of the ugly duckling of the discography. This wasn't the Weeknd's mysterious first appearance. You could Google what Abel Tesfaye looked like at the time, but it also wasn't his blow up into the mainstream. That would come just under 2 years later with a little album called Beauty Behind the Madness. But that doesn't mean that Kiss Land isn't a breathtaking, heartfelt, thought-provoking, unique, and important body of work in its own right. Not at all. It's easy to forget how chaotic the making of Kiss Land actually was. In 2011, within less than 1 year, Weeknd released three album-worthy mixtapes: House of Balloons, Thursday, and Echoes of Silence. Three mixtapes, a trilogy of mixtapes that weren't just next level shit for the time, but would go on to redefine the sound of pop music for the decade. Oh, and he also featured on and helped write a significant chunk of Drake's second album, Take Care. Wow, that's a lot. Talk about 0 to 100. In a few short months, Abel had gone from being almost completely unknown to being one of the most talked about artists in R&B. And then on top of that, the next year he had to tour those three mixtapes. In 2012, Abel performed 108 shows internationally. Kiss Land was born out of that. I'd argue that the biggest reason why Kiss Land has been mostly forgotten is because it was marketed as a debut album when it was really the second chapter of the Weeknd saga. It's a direct sequel to Trilogy, but if you look up the early reviews for this album, you'll notice that the most common criticism is that it's too samey to Trilogy. Then there's the album's lack of mainstream appeal. This album isn't really an easy introduction to The Weeknd. There aren't any artist-defining songs on here. There's no Blinding Lights or The Hills. I mean, you look at Weeknd's Highlights album, and there's not a single track from Kiss Land on it. There's nothing wrong with that, of course, because the album bleeds together into one crazy sonic journey. The production is grand and helps tell this dramatized version of Abel's real life. I bet you could listen to just these instrumentals and still feel like a story was being told. There are so many brass and string sounds that make the album feel huge, that make it feel like the score to a film. By now I've made it clear on this channel how much I love how Weeknd uses his love of movies to inspire his music. His albums are, to me at least, as much a visual experience as they are a sonic one. And Kiss Land is no different. The album cover even looks like a shot out of a film. For this project, Abel was particularly influenced by horror movies, especially those by John Carpenter, David Cronenberg, and Ridley Scott. He wanted the album to capture fear, the fear of being by yourself and away from home, which is why Japanese designs are used so prominently in the music videos and packaging for the album. House of Balloons represented Toronto, but the title Kiss Land was meant to represent the tour life, friendly enough on the outside, but deep down, an utterly terrifying place. Kiss Land does this fascinating thing. It takes the exact same Weeknd we know from Trilogy and places him in this unfamiliar world of money and fame. Literally all that's changed about his life is the scenery and the amount of zeros at the end of his bank statement. It's all about Weeknd's first ever trip out of Toronto after living in poverty for 21 years. How does this newly famous yet promiscuous dude react to that? The opener of the album, Professional, begins with Weeknd singing to this mysterious, nameless person, but we slowly realize that he's actually talking to himself. It's the Weeknd talking to Abel, who has come into grips with the new fame he's fallen into. He's a professional artist now. This sets such a strong atmosphere. Abel just feels a sense of dread, a sense of fear, that all of the success he's indulged in since becoming famous is too good to be true. Weeknd taunts Abel about being a somebody in a nobody town, talking about how he has to leave Toronto and his old life behind if he wants to go further and reach higher. I love how this dynamic between the two sides of Abel is played off like an abusive relationship. It's like the side that wants to take some time to better himself is being buried alive by the side that wants to pursue more and more material success. This intro part of the song ends with Weeknd saying, "Now I decide when we're through," implying that this party monster side has fully taken over. Yeah, we're in for one hell of a ride with this album. Almost immediately, Weeknd starts feeling the consequences for leaving, with the song Adaptation. Weeknd sings about choosing to trade a real relationship with a girl he loved back in Toronto for the tour life. Because he's on tour, he's already a long physical distance away from this girl, but he's increased that emotional distance by sleeping in 1,000 beds with other women. He's been flying around the world and killing shows, but he still feels empty. Weeknd even admits that he could have stayed with her, but he instead gave in to his selfish desires. But I chose the life, I chose the life, then I realized she might have been the one. I let it go for a little fun. So Weeknd regrets his choice, but at the same time, he thinks that all he has left is to adapt to the models and lose himself even further in his new reality. Now there's this really interesting comparison that The Weeknd uses on a bunch of songs on Kiss Land between himself and a prostitute. It shows up on Professional, The Town, Wanderlust, and to the best extent on Belong to the World. Basically, Weeknd is singing about how he relates to the lifestyle of a sex worker because he can't emotionally attach himself to any of the women he hooks up with anymore. Weeknd loves that she's only in it for the money of her clients and is completely emotionless towards all of them. She belongs to the world. The thing is though, in a roundabout way, this has taught him how to feel again. They are both professionals in love. They don't treat sex like it's personal and they never get heartbroken. But Weeknd questions, what actually is real love? It's hard for him to tell when he's been exposed to so much transactional sex, so much fake love, that it has no meaning anymore. It's dispensable. Has Weeknd dug himself into this hole? Yes, but you have to remember that this is an album about someone who is entirely new to fame, becoming overwhelmed by and numb to that fame. Him making awful decisions is kind of the point. Speaking of awful decisions, the next song features a verse from Drake. How long do you think it's gonna take for y'all to fall? That's a serious question, cause I seriously question all of y'all. Alright, I'm kidding. You can take that dislike off. Yep, there you go. Drake actually matches the tone of this part of the album, where Weeknd is fully immersed in the tour life and has no restraint whatsoever. It's kinda like that long section in The Wolf of Wall Street, where Jordan is just winning non-stop. The title track of Kiss Land gives us the most extreme depiction, the peak of this no fucks given character, that if we're being completely honest, we all love to hear about in Weeknd's music. I went from staring at the same four walls for 21 years to seeing the whole world in just 12 months. Been gone for so long, I might have just found God. Well, he's saying that being on tour has turned him into someone or something unrecognizable. His routine has become getting high, playing a show at night, and then waking up in the morning with someone new. Rinse and repeat.
Of course, a lot of it is a character.
Yeah.
That guy is, it is who I am, you know? Sometimes you take him and then you create more and then it becomes this beast. And you kind of just add more to him and then it's just uncontrollable, his own character. And it just sounds good. He sounds good. It's like Scarface. It's like the villain. It's like, it's horrible, but you can't stop looking at it.
So with that, we enter the final act of Kiss Land, where Weeknd comes back home and realizes that the girl he left behind has cheated on him whilst he was away touring the world. And you will never feel so pretty, and you will never feel this beautiful, oh, when I make it there, oh, when I make it there. He feels betrayed, even though he's been out doing the exact same thing on a way larger scale. You look at the music video for Pretty, and it's a complete revenge fantasy where Weeknd kills his ex and her new man whilst they're in bed. Which begs the question, why does Weeknd feel so heartbroken? I like to think that every Weeknd album, aside from maybe Starboy, is a modern tragedy. They always conclude with Weeknd losing something, whether that be a lover, a part of himself, or both. Just like how Kiss Land began with Weeknd singing to himself, it ends the same way. He tells himself to, Weeknd is no longer angry at his ex, but he's horrified by himself. It's not just that this girl might have been the one, but she might have been his last chance ever for real love. He's embraced this world of fame now, where he'll never be sure if someone actually loves him for him, or just for his money and status. So Kiss Land not only represents Weeknd transitioning into the pop icon we know him as today, but also him transitioning into the scary world of Hollywood, which he would begin to explore even further on his next albums.